Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Capital City, Gentrification and the Real Estate State by Samuel Stein, narrated by Emily Beresford. Introduction. On March 25, 1911, fire engulfed New York's Triangle Shirtwaist Factory. The bosses had locked the doors, and 146 workers were killed. 2 days later, the Jewish socialist newspaper, The Forward, printed an impassioned plea from its editor, Abraham Cahan. After describing the pain felt throughout Manhattan's Lower East Side, Cahan wrote that mourners were beginning to see a figure through their tears, the biblical angel of death. Who is the angel of death? Who is the thug? Who is the mass murderer? Must we again say it is that gluttonous ravager of humans? Capital? Just over a century later, a public housing complex in West London, called the Grenfell Tower, burst into flames. Though residents had warned that the building was a fire trap, public authorities allowed it to deteriorate. When the fire started, it quickly accelerated due to the highly flammable cladding that management had added to the building's exterior in order to make it more attractive to posh neighbors. The fire killed over 70 tenants. Who is the angel of death? Who is the mass murderer? Today, as a century ago, the culprit is capital, rushing in and out of spaces with abandon in search of profit and growth. In 1911, the arsonist was industrial capital, then the dominant force in urban politics. In 2017, it was real estate capital. Around the world, more and more money is being invested in real estate, the business of building, buying and renting land and property. You can sense it as you walk through most cities, and feel it every time you pay the rent or mortgage. Global real estate is now worth $217 trillion, 36 times the value of all the gold ever mined. It makes up 60% of the world's assets, and the vast majority of that wealth, roughly 75%, is in housing. There are a number of reasons why capital is converging on land and buildings. A long period of financial deregulation, low federal interest rates, and quantitative easing in the United States, massive urbanization programs in China, the United Arab Emirates, and several other countries, a proliferation of predatory equity funds scouring the globe for undervalued investment opportunities and finding them in housing, economic polarization around the world, with extremely wealthy and somewhat nervous individuals viewing property as the safest place to hide their money, and more. When capital gains rise, while rates of profit plummet across many once dynamic sectors of the economy, real estate becomes the latest stop on what geographer Cindy Katz calls vagabond capitalism's eternal search for profitability. In the United States, homes are changing hands at a rapid pace, but home ownership is at a 50-year low. In 2016, a record 37% of home sales were made to absentee investors. While some of those buyers were pensionless seniors who needed a retirement strategy, most of them were banks, hedge funds, and private equity firms like Blackstone, now the world's largest landlord. As renting rises, so do rents. Average move-in rents in the United States have more than doubled over the last two decades. Prices vary dramatically across the country, but the trend is clearly upward, with the fastest growth in mid-sized cities like Seattle, Portland, Denver, and Cincinnati. Wages, however, remain stagnant, putting tenants in a bind. There is not a single county in the country where a full-time, minimum-wage worker can afford the average two-bedroom apartment. Rent burdens, the percentage of income tenants put toward housing, are becoming oppressive, particularly for people of color in segregated neighborhoods. Around the country, rent burdens in Black neighborhoods average 44%. In Latino neighborhoods, it's 48%. Every month in New York City, almost 2 million people pass most of their income to landlords. With wages flat, many people, even those with full-time jobs, simply cannot afford stable housing. Last year, as cities and states continued to pass punitive legislation against the poor, about 2 million people in the United States went homeless, and 7 million more lived in precarious housing situations, doubled or tripled up, couch surfing, or sleeping in shift beds. This opens the door to an entire industry of private homeless services, with philanthropic and real estate capital blended to find profits in extreme poverty. The force behind these trends is the growing centrality of urban real estate to capital's global growth strategy. Through this process, the price of land becomes a central economic determinant and a dominant political issue. The clunky term gentrification becomes a household word, and displacement an everyday fact of life. Housing becomes a globally traded financial asset, creating the conditions for synchronized bubbles and crashes. Government, particularly at the municipal level, becomes increasingly obsessed with raising property values and redistributing wealth upward through land and rents. Real estate developer Donald Trump becomes first a celebrity and ultimately a president. Taken together, we witness the rise of the real estate state, a political formation in which real estate capital has inordinate influence over the shape of our cities, the parameters of our politics, and the lives we lead. The real estate state is not new, nor is it all-encompassing. Like the carceral state, the warfare state, the welfare state, or the administrative state, it is an expression of government, a component, a block, a manifestation, a tendency that has been around in one form or another as long as states and private property have existed. Landowners have been determining the shape of cities for centuries, and the idea of housing as a commodity, even as a financial asset, is not exactly state-of-the-art. What is relatively new, however, is the outsized power of real estate interests within the capitalist state. As real estate values have risen to absurd heights, so has the political force of real estate capital. The real estate state is a feature of government at all levels, from the hyper-local to the global. It is most firmly grafted onto municipal governments, however, because that is where much of the capitalist state's physical planning is done. City planners, therefore, sit uncomfortably at the center of this maelstrom. Planners manage the levers of urban change and make crucial decisions about land use, transportation, housing, the environment, and more. Though most people have no idea what they actually do, planners have an immense impact on both capitalists and workers in cities and suburbs. In most places, planners are tasked with the contradictory goals of inflating real estate values while safeguarding residents' best interests. Capitalism never made planning easy. Organized money could always thwart the best-laid plans. But today's urban planners face an existential crisis. If the city is an investment strategy, are they just wealth managers? This book is about planners in cities run by real estate. It describes how real estate came to rule and what planners do under these circumstances. Planners provide a window into the practical dynamics of urban change, the way the state both uses and is used by organized capital, and the power of landlords and developers at every level of government. They also possess some of the powers we must deploy if we ever wish to reclaim our cities from real estate capital. Understanding planners is an important way to understand the capitalist state, how it is built, and what it would take to dismantle it. While the nexus of planning and real estate is a powerful dynamic in nearly every city, I mostly focus on the United States and often use New York City as a prime example. I realize there is some risk in focusing on New York. For a U.S. city, it is exceptionally large, dense, and expensive. But as the biggest city in the United States, it serves as an example for many other places. Planners from around the country look to New York for new patterns and practices. It is also a place where real estate's rule is clearly seen and deeply felt. The rents are outrageous, and the cost of living is among the most persistent public issues. Most of all, though, I use New York because it is my home and the place from which I see the world. I know its gridded streets as well as its crooked politicians, and I've lived here long enough to feel like the city knows me, too. I am a planner. Though I don't work for a government agency, and I'm not in charge of managing any physical spaces, I was trained as a planner, and I maintain elements of the planner's worldview. to be simultaneously abstract and concrete, utopian and pragmatic, to imagine what doesn't yet exist while figuring out how to get there, to care about systems and processes, the way things work and the way they ought to. Fundamentally, we believe it is a good idea to have a plan, an explication of the future. Planning is a way of knowing the world as well as a way of remaking it. Like a lot of people, I became interested in planning because I was mad at planners. I loved my city, but I hated what it was becoming. I came to know New York at the start of the 21st century, when it seemed like construction cranes were as common as pigeons, and scaffolding was the new streetscape. Gigantic glass towers were rising all over the place, reflecting the old city grotesquely through their distorted mirror facades. I thought the architecture was stupid, but that wasn't what really bothered me. I was working for a union, and though we were winning big victories, there was a growing sense that the city we were fighting for was disappearing all around us. The working-class people who made the city could no longer afford to live in it. Rents were skyrocketing, and culturally important spaces were shuttering. I learned the rents law's limits when I was kicked out of a low-cost apartment. It was a stark lesson in landlord-tenant power relations. My landlord tried to kill the downstairs neighbors and torch the place, but he got to keep the building. The lessee had sublet the apartment to me without registering, and we were served an eviction notice. I was excited by some endeavors that the New York City planners were undertaking at the time, like building public plazas and extending the bike network, but I knew these benefits were linked to larger plots, rezonings that brought luxury development, megaprojects that turned the urban fabric threadbare, and management schemes that turned public goods into private fiefdoms. I pursued planning because I wanted to understand how the city works and to figure out how to preserve the best parts and change the worst. I believed in planning's promise of better spaces and a better society, even if I understood intuitively that planners had not exactly delivered on it. I had two basic questions. First, how much planning will capitalism allow in market-based systems? And second, how can we improve our cities without inducing gentrification and displacement? I spent 2.5 years studying planning history and theory, quantitative and qualitative methods, public finance, transportation, housing, and more. I learned a little about planning and a lot more about how planners think. There were tons of good ideas bandied about, and countless practical ways to reapportion space and rethink urban infrastructures. But I had a hard time answering my questions. It seemed like the system allowed quite a bit of planning intervention when it benefited business, including massive infrastructure projects and tax incentives for development, but it imposed strict limitations on planners who aimed to alter the balance of power. These limits are especially hard drawn when it comes to private property and real estate, which meant answering my second question, how can we improve cities without sparking displacement, wasn't going to be easy either. There appeared to be a close link between good planning and gentrification, since private property owners could capitalize on the value the state adds to land. By the end of my education, I realized that capitalism makes the best of planning impossible. Any good that planners do is filtered through a system that dispossesses those who cannot pay. Planning today is defined by incredible dreams and stultifying realities. A planner's mission is to imagine a better world, but their day-to-day work involves producing a more profitable one. They almost universally espouse a commitment to pluralism and diversity, but the profession is 58% male and 81% white, demographics that are way out of step with the residents of the cities where most planners work. Though most planning offices are structured to build continuity across changing administrations, planners are still beholden to politicians and their political appointees. Their agendas almost always tend to favor their most powerful supporters, a group that usually includes some strain of real estate capital. And while planning is a public function, planners in capitalist cities are always at the mercy of the market, since most of what they do is regulate private actions. The money planners have to work with is largely derived from property taxes, an arrangement that incentivizes developer and homeowner-friendly policies and restricts the amount of land that is given over to truly public uses. A private land market is essentially a spoils system. Whoever owns the land keeps the accrued benefits, whether or not the owner is responsible for them. Until land is socially controlled, those who possess property, capital, and access to power will shape planning priorities. With so much global capital invested into real estate, planners are facing enormous pressure to stoke land markets and enable gentrification. Their charge is to find creative ways to raise property values, either because they are low and landowners want them higher, or because they are already high and city budgets will fail if they start to fall. Any seemingly technical discussions of growth, density, or urban form are always also shaped by this imperative. Planners are not just shills to real estate, though. They can, and generally want, to make spaces more beautiful, sustainable, efficient, and sociable. But without control over the land, the result of their work is often higher land prices, increased rents, and, ultimately, displacement. As some places endure this kind of land market inflation, others fall prey to disinvestment. Their land loses its exchange value, their residents are shut out of credit markets, and their buildings fall into dangerous disrepair. This leads to a landscape of radically uneven geographical development between capital-flush cosmopolitan centers like New York and London, and investment-scarce cities like Camden, New Jersey, and Blackpool on England's Irish Sea coast. Even within cities, the same inequalities are often evident from neighborhood to neighborhood. Gentrification cannot be a universal phenomenon. Money tends to come from one place and go to another, creating chaos on both ends. On the disinvested side, communities face terrible choices. Many want the benefits of good planning, safe streets, clean air, decent housing, but not the catastrophic tide of capital it summons. In these places, residents will often reject planners' interventions out of a well-founded fear that they will be kicked out of their neighborhoods before they ever enjoy the promised improvements. One recent example. In March 2017, New York State Governor Andrew Cuomo announced a major new initiative for the poorest parts of Brooklyn. The plan promised jobs, parks, healthcare, and housing at a cost of $1.4 billion. But Brownsville resident Dayon Hopkins was skeptical. He had already been displaced from Bedford-Stuyvesant after that neighborhood started to gentrify. Pointing to an ordinary building, he told a New York Times reporter, "They'll take this right here and put a glass door, a brick wall on one side of the hallway, and now it's a loft, and now it costs way more than people are making around these parts. And I understand, it does get nicer, but where's everybody else going to go? Down south? Where are we going to go?" Hopkins says what most planners won't, that as long as some people's business is to profit off land and property, most people will not be able to enjoy the benefits planners promise. Of course, it doesn't have to be this way. We can imagine a better world. In fact, we must. First, however, we need to understand how we got here and how the system works. I wrote this book for anyone who is frustrated with both the direction their cities are taking and the alternatives planners are offering. I put planners at the center of the story because they are uniquely positioned at the nexus of state, capital, and popular power. On their own, however, planners cannot unwind real estate's grip over our politics. For that, we will need organized people, mass movements to remake our cities from the ground up and gain control over our homes and lives. Such movements have been a consistent feature of urban life and have grown and adapted to face new challenges. Gentrification is brutal, but rarely total, not only because colonizers always rely on the labor of a local workforce, but also because people always fight back, as individuals, as families, of birth and of choice, as communities, local and international, as neighbors and as a class. Even after displacement, people find a way to remake their spatial cultures and rebuild their social ties. Not just to survive, but to fight back anew. Gentrification's apologists will see this and claim displacement is not that bad. People are resilient. They move. They rebuild. They're fine. My point is precisely the opposite. Human beings will always resist regimes in which land ownership gives a small number of people enormous power over the lives of all others. People will fight back, and I believe that we will win. I hope this book contributes to that fight. It is made not only to be studied, but to be used. 1. The Rise of the Real Estate State. What is planning? What exactly do planners do? Planning is the way we shape space over time. In geographer Ruth Wilson Gilmore's terms, the point of planning is to have some sense of how to secure the future. It happens on multiple scales. Individuals plan for their own survival and advancement. Households plan ways to make their incomes stretch and their futures brighter. Businesses plan in highly structured and rigorous ways, creating schemes to eclipse the competition and increase their profitability. Communities and movements plan strategies for survival and resistance and produce insurgent plans that chart the way from deprivation to freedom. Often, however, what we talk about when we talk about planning is government. For more than a century, professional planners have been a crucial element of the state and have made important decisions about the ways our cities and towns function. In the United States, planners are usually municipal employees, but they work in all levels of government and include outside actors, consultants, designers, nonprofits, and so on, who seek to influence land use decisions. They survey and map the physical and cultural landscape, plot what can go where and at what size and shape, design infrastructure systems to move people and products, and channel investment and development toward certain places and away from others. The nature of planning in capitalist democracies, like the United States, is mercurial and contradictory. No city is entirely planned, but none is devoid of planning. Our political discourse valorizes the free market in a way that makes planning seem unnecessary. Yet the United States has consistently regulated its urban spaces in important and powerful ways. Americans often think of planners as either bureaucratic cogs or totalitarian tyrants, but planners tend to see themselves as promoters of fairness and protectors of the common good. Throughout the profession's history, planners have enacted a pair of opposing tendencies. A pragmatic utopianism, which aims to bring about a new world from the structures, if not the ashes, of the old, and a crude commitment to capital, which divides space by race and seeks ever newer frontiers for private development. U.S. planners are committed to both securing social reproduction, or ensuring that people have the means to survive into the future, and to turning everyone's space into someone's profit. They are motivated by the social movements that animate history, as well as by the economic powers that structure political realities. This assures that the beauty of urban planning is always accompanied by its horrors. In the words of planning scholar Ananya Roy, planning's promise of creation and creativity is not possible without a frontier of destruction. The rise of professional planning. The practice of planning is as old as human settlement, and in the United States, it reflects all the conflicts and contradictions of this country's history. Indigenous nations planned both stable settlements and migratory villages throughout the Americas, which included residential and commercial areas, as well as open spaces and commons. In a spatial form of primitive accumulation, European imperialists and settler colonists built on these plans and often superimposed their street grids over existing native trails. By 1573, the Spanish Crown published their Orders of Discovery, New Settlements and Pacification, which codified decades of colonial town planning practice into a set of strict standards for spatial segregation, ordered development, and efficient extraction. Planning scholar Clyde Woods argues that the United States' first real plan was for the total elimination, marginalization, or exile of indigenous people. Proto-planners enabled the country's murderous westward expansion and mapped the rail networks and other infrastructure that made it possible. The plantations that eventually dotted and dominated the southern landscape were a highly planned built form, which in turn created a template for future U.S. urban and suburban development, as well as contemporary factories in the fields. Within the plantation, however, slaves planned their own plots, spaces in which to cultivate their own food and practice everyday acts of resistance. While early town designs were largely imported from European models and reflected Greco-Roman and Enlightenment-era conceptions of order and environmental control, other essential American forms, such as the skinny, rectangular, shotgun house design common in the South, were derived from long-standing West African architectural practices. The United States' largest city, New York, was built on Lenape land as a series of scattered settlements emerging from Lower Manhattan. By 1811, city leaders had imposed a rigid street grid pattern and a standardized set of 25 by 100-foot lots, literally paving the way for future real estate development. The main exception to the grid, Broadway, was superimposed over a pre-existing Native American trail. Long before zoning became common practice throughout the country, New York exerted land use and social controls through fire codes and nuisance laws. While the practice of planning has therefore long been established, the profession of planning is a more recent phenomenon. Modern urban planning emerged in Europe and the Americas as a formal art, science, and vocation in the mid-19th and early 20th centuries, a moment of rapid industrial expansion, massive rural-to-urban and international migration, and widespread social, economic, and political upheaval. In Europe, the establishment of urban planning followed a series of proletarian uprisings in the major cities of England, France, Germany, and beyond. The most famous case is Baron Haussmann's reorientation of Paris. In the mid-19th century, after a series of barricaded rebellions broke out on the city's streets, a form of working-class insurrectionary planning, Napoleon III appointed Haussmann to remake Paris's physical layout, driving wide boulevards through the city's neighborhoods and displacing thousands. This reflected not just an aesthetic preference for strong sight lines and harmonious architecture, but the ruling class's desire to defend their hold on the city and prevent more working-class uprisings. In the United States, planning's formalization tracked not only with northern industrialization and the burgeoning labor movement, but also the end of Southern Reconstruction, which in 1935, sociologist W.E.B. Du Bois characterized as a revolution comparable to the upheavals in France in the past, and in Russia, Spain, India, and China today. In cities like Chicago, grand Haussmann-esque plans were drawn up to modernize the city, ironically by imposing neoclassical design aesthetics and attract real estate and industrial capital. In cities like Birmingham, planners wrote land use codes to simultaneously attract mining investment and suppress black labor mobility. In both the European and U.S. cases, the planning profession arose at moments of extreme social contest and turmoil, which were expressed in fights for control over land. It is no coincidence, then, that from its onset, urban planning has contained both reformist strands, which sought to maintain elite control of urban space while smoothing over capitalism's rough spots, and radical visions, which imagined planning as a means to overturn the social order and create and maintain a socialist society. A brief history of U.S. urban planning. Early U.S. planning history is marked less by bold experiments in egalitarian design than systematic attempts to juice urban land markets for private gain. These initial planning impulses were formulated through three interlocking urban movements, each of which left a profound legacy on contemporary planning and city life. Progressive reformism, city beautiful, and city practical. Progressive reformers tried to reshape the city toward three simultaneous ends: to ensure the social reproduction of a rapidly growing industrial labor force, to quell the urban rebellions that were rocking 19th and early 20th century cities, and to boost profits. In some cities, this took the form of municipal socialism, in which public monopolies took control of infrastructure development and maintenance. In others, progressives developed settlement houses, which provided much-needed social services to poor urban migrants, while also imposing norms of patriarchy and Protestantism. Perhaps the progressive reform movement's most enduring legacy in U.S. cities was imposing building codes, which provided minimum construction standards that promoted health and safety. The New York City tenement laws of 1867, 1879, and 1901, for example, ensured that new residential buildings would have fire escapes, air shafts, windows, and toilets. In so doing, these laws managed to simultaneously create somewhat safer housing while driving up property values. The result was that the poorest families could not live in new tenements and were relegated to the least safe and worst maintained properties in the city. Meanwhile, rising land and construction costs centralized new housing development in the hands of a wealthy elite. City Beautiful was perhaps the first self-identified planning movement in the United States, coalescing around the inaugural 1909 National Conference on City Planning and Congestion, and setting a high standard for urban design and aesthetics. Before all else, however, City Beautiful was a real estate program that sought to attract investment by building massive, Beaux-Arts-inspired municipal buildings, tree-lined boulevards, and carefully manicured open spaces. The movement is frequently associated with architect Daniel Burnham, who created the 1909 Plan of Chicago before taking his approach to Detroit, Washington, D.C., and U.S.-occupied Manila. But its presence is also felt in New York, from the Manhattan Municipal Building to Grand Central Terminal. Inspired in part by Hausmann, City Beautiful projects were often built on centrally located land inhabited by poor people, immigrants, and African Americans, who were treated as wholly incompatible with and undeserving of urban beauty. Central Park, for example, was built over the largest black settlement in Manhattan, Seneca Village, and also displaced large numbers of Irish and German immigrants who were living on coveted real estate. While local elites desperately wanted a more beautiful city, they refused to either pay for these developments or relinquish control over them. The solution, then, was a system of municipal planning with strong public input, the City Planning Commission. Established in most U.S. cities in the first half of the 20th century, these largely unelected commissions were often populated by real estate elites who tried to ensure that city planning decisions would stimulate profits. They approved monumental projects, grand boulevards, parks, museums, municipal complexes, and more, which resulted in higher urban property values and were largely paid for by the public. Planning commissions marked the shift from City Beautiful to City Practical. During a time when cities were growing chaotically and radical social movements were gaining steam, this less famous but profoundly important movement aimed to formalize and expand the scope of planning in the United States in order to rationalize urban and peri-urban expansion. Though rarely acknowledged, one of the most important forces behind City Practical was arch-conservative Herbert Hoover, who, as Secretary of Commerce from 1920 to 1928, oversaw the establishment of the Federal Standard State Zoning Enabling Act, SSZEA, and the Standard City Planning Enabling Act, SCPEA.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.